back on the chin with a chin lock on Rufus R. Jones. Rufus has the beard. Well, that's one way out. Rufus a bit angry. He didn't care to be strangled. He didn't care to be punched in the face by Pat Kelly. Pat, cautious. They lock fingers. Rufus twists around in that arm of Pat Kelly.
Five minutes left.
5 minutes remain in the curtain raiser between Pat Kelly and Rufus R. Jones. Kelly throws a punch to the head. That had no effect on Rufus. Rufus just laughs. The crowd claps for Rufus. And Rufus scores with a headbutt to the shoulder, a second headbutt to the shoulder of Pat Kelly, and then Rufus spins that arm around. Pat Kelly kicks out nicely. Another good move by Pat Kelly. Tough match between Kelly and Jones. Really not much advantage either way at this point. Side headlock by Kelly on Rufus. Kelly squeezing the head of Rufus. Rufus unlimbering the neck, loosening his whole body up. He just relaxes every muscle right from the neck on down. And that's really why he can slip that head out. He just relaxes everything, and he does it simply by the motion that you saw, and that's why he's able to slip the head free. The neck is totally, completely relaxed. Oh, Kelly throws a punch into the throat. A kick to the stomach, and down goes Rufus R. Jones. A knee lift into the side of Rufus's head, right along the cheekbone. And then Kelly again pulls back on the head. It's not a strangle. Eddie Smith checking that. Referee paying close attention. He knows that Kelly has a reputation as a bit of a rule breaker, but as Pat Kelly has given you ample demonstration during the opening minutes of this match, he can wrestle too. A kick to the back from Pat Kelly. And Pat once more grabs ahead of Rufus R. Jones. Pat Kelly certainly making his presence felt here against Rufus.
3 minutes left, 3 minutes.
Again, Rufus with the beard of Kelly. That gets his head free, but Kelly back on the attack quickly. Kelly hurls Rufus across the ring and into the corner. Kelly charges it, oh, and Rufus was waiting. Back rolling cradle, those shoulders are down, kind of one. And Kelly manages to shove Rufus off. Oh, and he walks right into a chop to the throat. A roundhouse right from Rufus R. Jones. The crowd urges on Rufus, and he scores a punch to the top of Pat Kelly's head. That drops the Irishman. A blast to the midsection by Rufus R. Jones. Kelly whipped to the ropes. Rufus charges, catches him, and drops him over the top. Look out now. The freight train is rolling. Flying tackle by Rufus R. Jones. Kelly staggers to his feet. A second flying tackle by Rufus. The crowd yells in glee as Rufus R. Jones scores with a headbutt. The headbutt by Rufus R. Jones. He covers Pat Kelly, and that's it. Rufus R. Jones, the freight train, they call him sometimes. You can see why. A pair of flying tackles and then the headbutt. Rufus R. Jones, the winner over Pat Kelly with a headbutt. Let's hear from ring announcer Mickey Garagiola.
In 7 minutes and 3 seconds with a headbutt, the winner, Rufus R. Jones.
Very good. He has a good grip on his ball.
He signed Sam Mutchick's name to all the checks.
Oh, an elbow smash to the head by Flair, and then he hooks O'Connor with that front face lock again.
The man has really got a grip. There's no doubt about it.
Well, he's a good tipper, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Pat?
All wrestlers, though. I think they are the top tippers.
I would think Ric Flair might be the best. I know he goes out somewhere to a fancy restaurant or somewhere to eat. He goes for the finest. Doesn't kid about it. Comes to town, makes sure he has a limousine waiting for him. Remember once he had to go back to Minneapolis, his hometown, for the wedding of a good friend of his. He had to wrestle that night, so he chartered his own jet to go from Charlotte, North Carolina to Minneapolis. Had the jet wait for him at the airport in Minneapolis, went to the wedding, attended the reception briefly, then flew back to Charlotte, North Carolina for a main event that night, and won. That's Ric Flair. He does it with style, my friends.
That's what you call a classy guy.
Forearm smash by Nature Boy Ric Flair. He pounds on Pat O'Connor. O'Connor pulled out to the center of the ring, and once more the front face lock.
10 minutes have expired. 10 minutes left.
Flair keeps his shoulders up as O'Connor tried to cradle him, but just couldn't get that leg. O'Connor underneath again for that low suplex. O'Connor pulls his head out. The head is free. That low suplex finally did the job. O'Connor spins Flair, trying to go for that backslide. It nearly worked before. Flair struggling against it. He's finally forced down. Lifts the arm right out, though. It was worth a try. It almost worked before. No question about that. Flair with a forearm smash. O'Connor with one. Flair and O'Connor. O'Connor hooks Flair, and both men go tumbling over the top rope and outside the ring. Flair and O'Connor both outside the ring. A heavy spill over that top rope. Neither man really in control of his body. They both went tumbling over the ropes. An elbow smash to the head by Flair. O'Connor pulls Flair back down and slams O'Connor into the ring apron. O'Connor trying to get back into the ring after slamming Flair into the apron. O'Connor reaches out for Flair, but it's Flair who grabs O'Connor, and Flair has O'Connor outside the ring and jams his knee into the steel ring post. Ric Flair jamming the knee of Pat O'Connor into the steel ring post. Flair ramming that knee into the post. Oh, Flair spotted an opening, and he's just like a shark going after blood. Flair punishing that leg around the ring post, and Pat O'Connor walked right into trouble there as Flair grabbed O'Connor and slammed that knee twice and then twisted it around the ring post. Flair punishing the leg of Pat O'Connor, spins it around the toe, going for the figure four leg lock. O'Connor breaks it, pulls that forward, try for a pin, but the legs of Flair free could not be cradled. Flair going for that leg again, trying to go for the injured leg of Pat O'Connor. O'Connor trying to keep his balance. O'Connor, seeing a wound on Flair's forehead, begins to pound on the head of Flair. And Flair, bleeding from an earlier wound that had been opened in a match, the head of Ric Flair opened up by Pat O'Connor. O'Connor pounding on the bloody head of Nature Boy Ric Flair. O'Connor's knee is hurt. He knew he was in trouble, and he went right for the head of Flair. Flair bleeding, the blood pouring through the blonde hair of Nature Boy Ric Flair. Something else that Ted DiBiase can attack, maybe, but more importantly, it's something that Pat O'Connor, who's still favoring that leg, can attack. Flair, the blood streaming down his head. There's the sleeper! The sleeper by Pat O'Connor on Nature Boy Ric Flair. Flair bleeding and trapped in the sleeper. Oh, both men go flying over that top rope again as O'Connor and Flair went to the ropes. Flair, the blood pouring off his head. O'Connor, oh, he almost lost his balance when he got up with that bad knee. Flair misses a punch. O'Connor with the sleeper outside the ring. The sleeper outside the ring. O'Connor and Flair. O'Connor with the sleeper. Oh, O'Connor jammed backwards. O'Connor jammed backwards into the steel ring post. The bloody Ric Flair. He's going for the figure four. Flair with the figure four on O'Connor outside the ring. The bloody Ric Flair with the figure four on Pat O'Connor outside the ring. The referee counting on both men. He's up to 15, 16, both men being counted on. Flair, the blood streaming down his face. The count's up to 19. Flair's in the ring. O'Connor with the injured knee is outside the ring. And Nature Boy Ric Flair has the victory. O'Connor counted out outside the ring. O'Connor has been injured, slammed backwards into the steel ring post. And then Flair applying the figure four leg lock outside the ring. O'Connor has been hurt. He can't straighten that leg out, and Ric Flair, even bleeding, had what it takes to come up with a victory. Let's hear from Mickey.
13 minutes and 40 seconds. Referee Charles Venetas counts out Pat O'Connor, the winner, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Thank you.
And Rhodes drives that elbow to the top of Romeo's head. A hard jab, and Dusty Rhodes starts flailing away at Benny Romeo. You want a battle? Rhodes does it, and he does it with flair, I should say. Rhodes again with that body drop into the thigh and then scissors the ankle. A cut opened up between the eyes over the right eye of Dusty Rhodes. An old wound, I'll tell you. Dusty's been through the wars. He likes a Donnybrook as much as anyone. He and the Bruisers, you get along wonderfully. You can see all the battle scars on the head of Dusty Rhodes. Well, that's the price you pay sometimes when you're right at the top of the heap, when you draw the big money, when you're in the top matches, the lucrative matches. And Rhodes backs down from nobody. In which case, he should be very happy in that giant 18-man Wrestle Royal, the biggest Wrestle Royal ever in St. Louis, and the first time a Wrestle Royal has ever been on the same card as a World Championship match. 18 men in the ring at once. Think of that. People like Rhodes, Bruiser, Patera, Flair, Dick Murdoch, Kerry Von Erich, Rocky Johnson, Jack Briscoe, Bobby Heenan, Bulldog Bob Brown, Rufus R. Jones, Spike Huber, so many more. All 18 in the ring at once. A man eliminated when he is thrown over the top rope. The sole survivor in the ring, the winner. That is an all-star lineup. That's an understatement. You talk about the people that'll be in that royal. There's the standing leg split again by Dusty Rhodes on Benny Romeo. I wonder what would happen if it came down to Rhodes and the Bruiser, the last two men in that ring. Think about that. What would happen if it came down to Patera and Flair? Or Flair and Murdoch? Or Jack Briscoe and Dusty Rhodes? Look at all those combinations that could come down to the last two or three men, all 18 in the ring at once.
2 minutes left, 2 minutes.
Romeo throws a punch at the head of Dusty Rhodes. Rhodes trying to concentrate on scientific wrestling against Romeo. Only once that Dusty's had to resort to Donnybrook style against Romeo to teach him a lesson. But right now, it looks like Romeo wants to pound on Rhodes. He has to protect that leg. He's had a lot of trouble with the leg thanks to Dusty Rhodes. Rhodes slashes right back at Benny Romeo. The American Dream, as they call him, pounds on Romeo. That cut trickling blood down the nose of Dusty Rhodes once more. Well, Romeo started it, but Dusty Rhodes pounding on him may finish it. He hooks the head underneath, and the suplex by Dusty Rhodes on Benny Romeo. The suplex on Romeo, count of two, and Romeo gets that shoulder up.
1 minute left, 1 minute.
Rhodes with a side saddle suplex on Benny Romeo. Rhodes covers Romeo again, count of one, two. Romeo gets that shoulder off. He's trying to hang in there. The curfew time running out. Romeo trying to hang in, and Rhodes trying to finish him off. Oh, the elbow smash right to the jaw. Clotheslining Romeo. Dusty backs up. What have we here? The flying elbow drop. Oh, he smashes Romeo right into the mat, and Romeo's not getting up from that one. The flying elbow drop. Riveting Benny Romeo right to the canvas. We check the clock. That's going to be it. The only fall within the...
First main event, a one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing from Topeka, Kansas, weighing 252 pounds, Art Cruz. And from Germany, weighing 277 pounds, Von Raske, referee Lee Warren.
In the best of moods, Von Raske is usually furious. And Mickey Garagiola just ran out of that ring, and I think he's leaving the studio. Raske nearly trampled him while Mickey was introducing Art Cruz. Raske enraged. He has been ever since a recent tag match, which he and Big John Studd were together and got into an argument, and it cost Studd and Raske the match when Raske got punched in the jaw. So Von Raske, not at all in a good mood as he does battle with Art Cruz. What a challenge it is for young Art Cruz. They'll lock up. Raske goes underneath, fireman's carry. Nicely done by Von Raske. He covers Cruz, but Cruz gets a shoulder up. Raske moves behind Cruz. Cruz might be able to sit out. Lee Warren balls out Roschke for using the hair. There's no question why Ric Flair got that match with Harley Race. He has proven himself, and most recently by defeating David Von Erich with the figure four leg lock. Nobody else has been able to knock off David in St. Louis except the world champion himself, but Ric Flair did it with his favorite hold, the figure four leg lock. If it was enough to defeat David Von Erich, well, I'll tell you, it's enough to defeat Harley Race. And that gold belt could then very easily be around the waist of Nature Boy Ric Flair. Flair calls himself the uncrowned champion. Well, he can prove it, but he's going to have to prove it to the man who has that gold belt and who's been in command of the throne for more than 4 years. But again, maybe that is to the advantage of Nature Boy Ric Flair. Young, aggressive, ambitious, tremendously hungry to wear that gold strap around his waist. Flair and Race for all the marbles. Look at Flair's record. Not only has he beaten David Von Erich, twice he's defeated Ted DiBiase. He's beaten three former world champions, Pat O'Connor, Jack Briscoe, and Dory Funk Jr. Add that to all the other victories Ric Flair has, and the flamboyant, gaudy, boisterous Nature Boy Ric Flair is poised right on the edge. He's going to take that last step, but he has to take that step over Harley Race. And it won't be easy. It will be war. A best of three falls war when Nature Boy Ric Flair tries to take that gold belt from Harley Race. Roschke bridging and then using the hair, keeping Art Cruz down. Han Roschke. Saw him once wearing a t-shirt that says, "I know I'm cute." You form your own opinions. You had a good look at him right there, thanks to the fine camera work here at KPLR-TV. Whether you think he's cute or not, I'll tell you one thing, he's tough, he's good. Roschke bridging again to keep those shoulders up. Good in bridge, and that gives him the opportunity to use the hair. Lee Warren catches him and says, "Get out of that hair." Roschke comes up on top of Cruz and stomps on Cruz's head. Von Roschke, the punch to the forehead of Art Cruz. Oh, and Cruz almost lost his balance there and went backwards. Roschke grabs Cruz underneath, lifting him to the air. Where is Roschke going with Cruz? Backbreaker. Oh, and it was a dandy. A beautiful backbreaker by Roschke. Count of one, two. Cruz kicks Roschke off, and Roschke get angry again because Cruz wasn't down for a count of three. It's a heck of a backbreaker. That's a good one, right on target. You can see him driving the back into the knee.
10 minutes have elapsed, 10 minutes left.
Roschke pitched into that corner, and Cruz with a backflip tosses Roschke down. Cruz covers Roschke, try for a pin, only a count of one, and Roschke gets away. Cruz with an uppercut, that forearm banging home on the chin of Roschke. Roschke hurled into the corner. Cruz charges in. Oh, Roschke got right out of the way, and Cruz crashed into that top turn. Look at Roschke's hand. He's poising that claw. The iron claw, the brain claw, as he calls it, the brain claw of Von Roschke. Roschke with the brain claw on Art Cruz. That's Roschke's favorite. He says it's the best claw in wrestling, better than anything that Von Erichs can do, according to Roschke. Roschke digging in with that claw on Art Cruz. Cruz trying to struggle out of it as Roschke digs into the temples and the forehead. Cruz down on his back. Roschke digging in with the brain claw. Look at the muscles in his neck straining as Roschke pours on the pressure with the brain claw. Cruz, the referee checking his arms. He's out. He's out. And Von Roschke with the brain claw defeats Art Cruz. He saw the opening for it, and Roschke with the claw is the winner over Art Cruz. Roschke wins it. Here's Mickey Garagiola.
In 10 minutes and 59 seconds, the brain claw, the winner, Von Roschke.
Kerry Von Erich circling, tying up. Better not forget Big John Studd. He wants his name included. Von Roschke. Front face lock by Blood. Oh, look out! Suplex by Kerry Von Erich. Oh, what a suplex by Kerry. But Blood rolls away from the elbow drop. And Blood again with a front face lock on Kerry Von Erich. Kerry and one of his brothers, David, certainly have a very important match coming up against the Kelly twins. That's certainly unique in itself, brothers versus brothers. The Kelly twins against the Von Erich brothers, Kerry and David. Of course, you know that Pat Kelly had to step in as a substitute at last second's notice against Kerry Von Erich. He was beaten by Kerry, but he wants revenge. Both of the Kellys want revenge. They say Pat certainly wasn't prepared for the match, had no idea it was coming. He just did it as a favor to promoter Sam Muchnick, stepping in at the last second when Ox Baker wasn't there. Well, the Kelly twins can get their revenge on the Von Erich family, and you can bet they intend to do it, because together the Kelly twins are as good a tag team combination as you'll find anywhere. The Kellys against the Von Erichs, brothers versus brothers, a unique match. Kerry and David Von Erich against the Kelly twins, Pat and Mike. A big challenge for both duos. And talk about unusual tag team combinations. Well, how about the one Dick the Bruiser and Bulldog Bob Brown on the same side against Bobby Jaggers and Dick Murdoch? Boy, there's a stormy combination. The Bruiser and the Bulldog together as partners. It's happened once before, and they were a good team. Oh, knee drop to the forehead by Kerry Von Erich on Mike Blood. A forearm smash to the back. A hard punch to the jaw drops Blood. I'll tell you, Kerry Von Erich's got a lot of his dad in him. He's got a short temper himself. If you play rough with Kerry, he'll play rough right back. Kick to the stomach by Mike Blood. Front face lock again on Kerry by Blood. Blood pitch to the ropes. Oh, drop kick by Kerry Von Erich. He caught Blood on the side. Didn't get all the way fully up to catch him in the face, but he got him in the side. And there's the Iron Claw. The Iron Claw by Kerry Von Erich on Mike Blood. Blood gets to the ropes. The Iron Claw that was invented by Kerry's father, Fritz, was used so well. It is now a major weapon for all of the Von Erichs, Kerry included. Blood quickly got to the ropes. Blood complaining about what Kerry was doing. But the claw is legal. He says he was also working on the eyes. Kerry says, no, no. Blood buying a little time, though.
Five minutes left.
Blood pulls Kerry Von Erich down. He has the arm and the head tied up. Kerry struggling to his feet. Mike Blood giving quite a good account of himself against Kerry Von Erich. Kerry thrown head first into that top turnbuckle. Again, Blood bounces Kerry's head off that top buckle and then a chop to the throat by Mike Blood. Blood opening up. He throws an elbow that misses. Kerry goes behind Blood. Oh, a reverse suplex. A reverse suplex tossing him from behind instead of a hip toss. Kerry tosses Blood to the ropes. Catches him with a stomach claw. Digging him with that stomach claw. Kerry Von Erich, look at this. Lifting him with the stomach claw into the air. A stomach claw in the air. And then a backdrop while applying the stomach claw. Do you believe that move by Kerry Von Erich? Blood gives up to the stomach claw. And I don't think I've ever seen a stomach claw done quite like that. You talk about power. Kerry trying to get those fingers loose to grip out of the stomach of Mike Blood. He dug into the stomach, lifted Blood into the air, and then dropped him backwards while still applying the stomach claw. Do you believe that? A victory by Kerry Von Erich. Here's Mickey.
In 5 minutes and 53 seconds with a stomach claw, the winner, Kerry Von Erich.
The elbow and shifts around an arm lock. That's it, Spike. Make a liar out of me. But it shows how many different holds you can do from one position. Spike Huber taking advantage of that fact, not letting Romeo set himself. Romeo, knowing he was having some trouble, began pounding on Huber, and now he tags J.J. Dillon and sets Huber up for Dillon. Dillon pounding on Huber. Dillon with a punch to the jaw. Forearm smashed by Huber, but then Dillon works on the face. Huber tries to get to Dillon. Dillon cuts him off. Dillon, less Huber. Hard body slam from J.J. Dillon. He covers Huber. Oh, Dillon, bench pressed off the top by Spike Huber. Tag made to Benny Romeo. Romeo pulls Huber to the corner and slams Huber head first into the turnbuckle. DiBiase steps into the ring, wants to come over and help his partner. The outside referee, Lee Warren, chases DiBiase back where he belongs. Here comes J.J. Dillon into the ring. A hard kick from Dillon. Dillon on the neck of Huber with that elbow. A punch to the mouth of Spike Huber by J.J. Dillon. Dillon lifts Huber. Huber skips behind him and tags Ted DiBiase. DiBiase comes into the ring and he tears into J.J. Dillon. Flying heel by the Missouri State champion. Drop kick by Ted DiBiase. DiBiase with a flying mare on J.J. Dillon. Oh, knee drop across the chest. If it had been the throat, it would have been an automatic disqualification, but it was right on the chest. It was legal. DiBiase catches Romeo coming off. Falling body slam. DiBiase with a spinning toe hold. And into the figure four leg lock. The figure four leg lock by Ted DiBiase on Benny Romeo. Yanking back, jerking on the ligaments and the cartilage. Romeo crying out in pain. The same figure four leg lock that put Ken Butera in the hospital for knee surgery. And it records the first fall of this match for the team of Ted DiBiase and Spike Huber against J.J. Dillon and Benny Romeo. Let's hear the time from Mickey Garagiola.
The winner of the first fall in 9 minutes and 4 seconds with the figure four, the team of Ted DiBiase and Spike Huber.
Himself over the top rope to bring on the disqualification. There is a suplex by Ken Butera. He's versatile, and Leonard feeling the effects of that suplex from Butera. Once more, Butera twists that head, stretching out the neck. Pain and aggravation, says Ken Butera. Look at the biceps bulge on that man. Oh, he is huge, Ken Butera. Leonard trying to score with some punches to the midsection of Butera, now manages to push Butera into the corner. Referee Eddie Smith wanting a break. Now Leonard using his shoulder to good advantage, jamming Butera backwards into the turnbuckle. That stung, and Butera is angry. He goes right after Leonard. Bangs on his neck with elbows. A kick into the rib cage from Ken Butera. Another kick into the side. Butera. Those kicks, though, were legal. They were with the instep, so they were legal. Again, Butera lifting Leonard. Where's he going with him? The shoulder breaker. Jamming the shoulder. That's a good way to separate someone's shoulder. The shoulder breaker by Ken Butera. Butera covers Leonard, and he won't pin him.
5 minutes have elapsed. 10 minutes left.
Leonard obviously finished, and Butera drops him throat first across the top rope. Ken Butera, really no reason for that. He's proven himself superior at this point. He had the man down clearly for a pin and then refused to pin him. Butera now is dishing out punishment to Tim Leonard. That shoulder breaker probably had turned the trick for Butera, but he's still not satisfied. Butera battering the head of Leonard into that top turnbuckle. Now Leonard desperately, in desperation, fighting back. Butera just took those forearm smashes and then gouged the eyes. The forearm smashes had no effect whatsoever on Ken Butera. A man of iron. Butera whips Leonard to the rope, then clotheslines Leonard, nearly bending him backwards, nearly splitting him in half. Look out, Butera moving behind Leonard. There's the full Nelson. The full Nelson and the swinging neck breaker. Butera whirling Leonard around. Tremendous pressure into the neck by Butera. Butera leaning into the neck with that swinging neck breaker. Leonard's going to have no choice but to submit. It's either that or go to the hospital. Leonard being pushed forward. He gives up, and Ken Butera simply tramples Tim Leonard. The count of three, he's going to get disqualified if he doesn't break that swinging neck breaker, which of course ends up in the full Nelson. What an impressive outing by powerful Ken Butera as he simply manhandles, crushes Tim Leonard.
In 6 minutes and 20 seconds, with the flying, with the spinning neck breaker, the winner, Ken Butera.
The referee's telling Race he has no business in the ring. Benny Romeo, Dillon's original partner, was injured. Huber charging after Dillon. Oh, Race grabbing Huber from outside the ring, dumps him. Now the referees go outside the ring trying to chase him back. Dillon on his own against Huber and DiBiase. Tag made to DiBiase. Race arguing with Lee Warren outside the ring. Here comes Sam Muchnick down to ringside. And Sam Muchnick going after Race to try and get Harley Race out of there. Sam and Harley Race to the far corner of the ring. Maybe we can get a shot of him. Race yelling at Muchnick. I'm sure he's complaining about why Dillon should have to be alone. Why should he have to be in a handicap tag match just because his partner is injured? Muchnick said, okay. Sam Muchnick approving Harley Race to be the partner of J.J. Dillon. I assume that's what happened. Yes, he said, okay. Lee Warren nodding. Race, okay, Race is the partner of J.J. Dillon. DiBiase taking his lumps, and there's a tag made to Harley Race. Dillon thrown away. I don't know if DiBiase knows Race is in there. Oh, Dillon! Dillon crashes right into Harley Race, knocking him right over the top rope. There's DiBiase going for the figure four leg lock. DiBiase with the figure four on J.J. Dillon. DiBiase, who's already crippled Benny Romeo, with the figure four leg lock on Dillon. Here comes Race on the top rope. Race on the top rope, diving headbutt from the top rope by Harley Race. The referees call for the bell, and I'm sure that Race has been disqualified for diving onto Ted DiBiase from the top rope. DiBiase sees Race there, and DiBiase is after Race. DiBiase is after Race. DiBiase pounding on the world champion. He knocks Race through the ropes and onto the apron. DiBiase after Race outside slams him head first into the steel ring post. Ted looked up and saw that Race was on that top rope. Race diving off the top rope to get DiBiase. Race is bleeding. Race is bleeding. DiBiase has pounded open the head of Harley Race. Race has bleeding. Ted DiBiase shoves the referee away, knocks Riley down. DiBiase pounding on the world champion. DiBiase whips Race to the rope. Catches him coming off of the backflip. Race has already been disqualified. The match is officially over. But Race going after, taking a battering from DiBiase again. Race knocked clear over the top rope by Ted DiBiase. DiBiase, a man possessed, when he saw Race come off the top rope, clearly an attempt to injure Ted DiBiase. It backfired on Race. Oh, Race head first into the steel ring post by the Missouri champion, Ted DiBiase. Race has been injured by DiBiase. Race getting pounded. Look out. Race. DiBiase trying to be restrained by Huber, Warren, and Chuck Riley. DiBiase pounding Race right out of the building, running him clear back to the dressing room. Race wanted to be the partner for J.J. Dillon after Romeo was hurt. He was knocked out of the ring. DiBiase got the figure four on the world champion. The world champion dived off the top rope. Here comes Pat O'Connor down to try and help calm DiBiase. O'Connor, of course, the assistant to promoter Sam Muchnick. O'Connor trying to calm DiBiase and Huber. Well, you saw it. The official verdict is that Race was disqualified for jumping off the top rope. The winners of the match then in two straight falls are DiBiase and Huber. And here's Mickey going to make the official announcement. DiBiase and Huber win it in two straight falls. Here's Mickey.
In 2 minutes and 50 seconds, referee Chuck Riley disqualifies Race, so the winner of the two falls and the match, Missouri State champion Ted DiBiase and Spike Hubert.
A little bit about why you should stay tuned today to Wrestling at the Chase. We have a Wrestle Royal coming up later today, so don't go away. DiBiase tying up the head of Oswald. Oswald squirms about, gets the shoulder up. Front face lock by the Missouri State champion. Nice subtle moves there. Oswald was moving around, but yet DiBiase kept control of the situation, kept control of his opponent. Look at him pull forward on that chin. It's well off the throat. We can see daylight in there, and Lee Warren, the referee, checking himself. Oswald tries to hook the head of DiBiase. Getting under the arm. Oh, look at DiBiase take advantage of what's there. Take advantage of what's presented to him. Had the hammerlock briefly and ends up with a side headlock. We talked about Ted DiBiase having it all in terms of youth and intelligence and skills. Been a few ladies out there watching say he also has good looks. All I know is when he comes into a building, he sure gets just mobbed by them. I don't think he minds it either.
A classy guy on top of it.
Very classy guy, definitely.
Real class.
Real fine gentleman. DiBiase working on the neck of David Oswald, bouncing that shoulder in there and stretching out the neck. Good, hard, tight wrestling right now by Ted DiBiase. But if things get wild and woolly, well, we'll ask Harley Race about that. He found out the hard way when things get wild and woolly what Ted DiBiase can do.
5 minutes have expired, 15 minutes left.
DiBiase yanks the man over, but cannot hold the shoulders out. Look at him, right back on top of Oswald. Oswald can barely breathe. DiBiase is all over him like flypaper. DiBiase squeezing the head with that side headlock. Oswald forces his way up. Grabs the hair of Ted DiBiase. Warren tells me, get that hand off. Knee lift into the midsection by Oswald. Oswald pounding on the back of Ted DiBiase. Oswald, knowing that it's rather useless to try and match holds with DiBiase, at least in this match today. DiBiase obviously is sharp and has everything going. He tries to rough up DiBiase. Oh, DiBiase fights back. Mickey Garagiola says, uh-oh, look out for that temper. Hard chop to the throat. Oh, did you hear that sizzler? Oswald jammed into the turnbuckles. DiBiase brings Oswald out, goes to the side. Side saddle suplex, crashing David Oswald to the mat. DiBiase hooks the head, goes underneath. What have we here? Oh, DiBiase going for the suplex. A message for Harley Race from Ted DiBiase, the suplex that Race himself uses. And there's a count of three. DiBiase using the suplex to pin David Oswald. You're never going to see an athlete in finer condition, mentally or physically, right there than that man, the Missouri State champion, Ted DiBiase. Here's Mickey.
In 6 minutes and 17 seconds with a suplex, the winner of the match, Missouri State champion, Ted DiBiase.
It's not a strangle. That's obvious. Now Brown trying to get up. He's scooting backwards. Maybe he can scoot out from underneath it. Roschke really squeezing the chin. Look out! Down goes Roschke. Brown tripping him as he pulls out with that back. Still painting Bulldog Brown, and Roschke follows up, banging his knee into the back of Bulldog Brown. Brown comes off the ropes. Roschke with a forearm right into the solar plexus. Perfect location on that forearm smash from Roschke. He covers Brown. Count of one, count of two. Brown kicks away. Roschke lining Brown up for the claw, the claw. Brown blocks it. Brown blocks the brain claw of Roschke. The claw being blocked by Bulldog Brown. Roschke straining, trying to get that claw on Brown. Look how close he is. Roschke trying to get that claw on Brown. Brown reaches up and gouges the eyes of Roschke. Oh, so close for Roschke. And the crowd urges on Brown.
10 minutes have expired, 10 minutes left.
Roschke pounding on the back of Bulldog Brown. That's still the vulnerable point on Brown. Body slam by Roschke. He covers Brown to go for a pin. No luck there. Brown's tougher than that. Brown staggering, favoring that back. Roschke lifted to the air by Brown. He suckered Roschke to him and scored with his own body slam. Count of one, Roschke kicks up, gets that shoulder up. Brown following Roschke, the chop to the throat. Brown again lifts Roschke. Roschke grabs the rope and pulls Brown over the top rope with him. Oh, Brown slams his head and arm against a chair at ringside. One of the spectators vacated the area. Roschke pounding on Brown outside the ring. Brown trying to fight back. Brown grabs Roschke's head, and Brown, though, is pushed away. Brown pushed away into the steel ring post. The count, Roschke chased back by the referee, and he has to start the count over because Roschke would not get back. Brown tried to run Roschke's head into the ring post. Instead, it was Roschke who shoved Brown off, and Brown hit the ring post after he'd already hit a chair at ringside with his head. Roschke being pushed back again by the referee. Brown up to the apron. He slams his shoulder into the stomach of Von Roschke. Roschke pounding on Brown. This is turning into Donnybrook. Brown working on the eyes of Von Roschke. Brown battering Roschke now. Both of these men showing the ability to absorb punishment and still fight back. Brown pounding on Roschke. Lee Warren trying to get him back. Oh, and Brown throws the referee aside. Brown. Roschke, and Roschke belts the referee. Down goes Lee Warren. Warren has been decked by both men, first Brown and then Roschke. They're over on top. Warren calling for the bell. Warren calling for the bell after he'd been decked first by Brown and then by Roschke. Brown and Roschke going at it hot and heavy. Referee Lee Warren trying to separate the two. Roschke backflip by Brown. Warren trying to pull the two apart, and Roschke crawls out of the ring. Oh, did Warren get clobbered by Roschke? Brown had earlier thrown Warren aside when he tried to separate the two. Mickey Garagiola checking with the referee what he wants to do. I think he may be disqualifying both men. Roschke outside the ring right by us, Brown in. Let's hear from Mickey Garagiola. Well, wait a minute, Brown coming out after him. Roschke throws a chair this way at Brown. Now Roschke grabbing a chair, and Brown and Roschke squaring off outside the ring. Referee Eddie Smith has come to ringside to help restore some order. Let's hear from Mickey Garagiola.
In 12 minutes and 2 seconds, referee Lee Warren disqualifies both wrestlers. This match is a draw.
Harley Race. He's pounding on Sexton. A punch to the head knocks Sexton through the ropes and out of the ring. Sexton knocked right out of the ring by the world champion Harley Race. You talk about tough, you start with the world champion Harley Race. Race outside the ring after Sexton. Race grabs Sexton, and he tried to shove Sexton into that ring post. Sexton, though, pushed Race forward, and it was Race who collided with the steel ring post. A good move, maybe made in desperation by Sexton, but it buys him some time, and now Sexton trying to get to Race while Race tries to regain his bearings outside the ring. Maybe Mr. Race got a bit too cocky against Sexton, started to count him out when Ron Sexton still had plenty of spunk and fire left. Race bides his time getting back into that ring. He caught that post right in the shoulder. Loosens the shoulder up. Waits for Sexton to come to him. Sexton reaches inside and catches Race with a forearm smash. A second one. A third forearm smash by Ron Sexton. A knee lift. And down goes Race. Flying elbow drop by Sexton. He covers the world champion. Sexton thrown off by Race. And then Sexton hooks the arm of the world champion. Sexton twisting back on the left arm of Harley Race. There's a guy who came up the hard way. He's the exception that proves the rule, really, because so many guys now in professional wrestling are coming out of college with that tremendous 8-9 year amateur background, starting way back in high school, or even junior high school. But Race came up the hard way. He was wrestling professionally when he was just a teenager. He took his lumps. Believe me, nobody took more beatings than Harley Race did in the first 4 or 5 years of his career. But slowly, surely, he learned the business. He learned what he could do. He learned what his body could take, and that body got harder every time out.
5 minutes have expired, 5 minutes left.
Today, I doubt there's anything that can happen inside a wrestling ring that hasn't happened to Race or he hasn't made happen. Side saddle suplex by Harley Race. He's been through the mill. He's paid his dues. And that's why that gold belt is so valuable to him. Ted DiBiase knows what it means to Harley Race as Race locks both arms of Sexton behind him and then takes him to the air with a suplex. The double arm suplex by Harley Race. Race lines up Sexton, poises that knee and bangs it into the head of Sexton. That is such a potent weapon of Harley Race. And of course you see things that Race started, that Race was the first to do, and many other wrestlers have copied. Some do it maybe as well, but none do it better than Harley Race. And there he is with Sexton up in the air. The suplex. poising him, making sure that he has full balance, full might, and he crashes Sexton backwards with that suplex. The world champion covers Sexton. Sexton isn't going anywhere. Harley Race pounding down and putting away Ron Sexton in fine fashion. He looks sharp. He is ready. Ted DiBiase, take note. That man is ready to defend the gold belt with his whole heart and being. Here's Mickey.
In 6 minutes and 2 seconds with the suplex, the winner, world heavyweight champion, Harley Race.
It's Wrestling at the Chase. And now, let's go to ringside with your announcer, Larry Madison.
Welcome to the fourth annual edition of the Best of Wrestling at the Chase. Hello, I'm Larry Madison. Wrestling at the Chase has been on the air since May of 1959, and the excitement generated just during the past year alone gives a good example of why wrestling has developed such a large and loyal following. Of course, with the high caliber of talent that's on display here every weekend, excitement is guaranteed. And that's particularly true when the ladies are on hand. Think back a bit to when the girls' tag team champions Wendy Richter and Joyce Grable clashed with Carol Summers and Jill Fontaine.
All four girls are battered right now. Summers grabs the arm of Wendy Richter. Fontaine has the arm of Grable, and Grable and Richter are they caught arms. Come up with drop kicks and miss. They miss the drop kicks after avoiding being rammed together. Lee Warren has to look at which two girls belong inside the ring. Eddie Smith trying to explain who belongs in there. Richter's outside the ring on one side, and Joyce Grable's out on the other. Richter's flat on her belly down the concrete floor, and she has a count of 20 to get back in that ring. Wendy Richter very upset with one of the fans as she begins to get back in there. She's taking full advantage of that count to try and regain her breath. Wendy Richter back up on the apron. Well, everything went wrong for Richter and Grable right there. Fontaine and Summers making their presence known now. Fontaine hooks the arms of Richter and catapults her clear across the ring. Fontaine again going for that double leg catapult. Into the air goes Richter. Her ribs must be disintegrated. Oh, that giant splash comes right down across the knees of Wendy Richter. For all her wildness, she uses her head. She got those knees up and caught Jill Fontaine right in the stomach. Fontaine hurled to the ropes and dropped by Wendy Richter with a forearm smash. Another smash drops Jill Fontaine. That Richter is so big and tough, she can take the punishment. She still comes back. It's like she hasn't taken a lump at all.
10 minutes have passed, 10 minutes left.
And I got to tell you something about Wendy Richter. She's got some bruises on her thighs. I can see a weld on her ribs. She's taken some beating in this match, but she's still able to come back, storm back. She just won't quit. Grable puts Fontaine down after gouging the eyes. Fontaine dropped. Most of the blows actually by Grable and Richter are forearm smashed, and that makes them legal punches. Grable right on top of Summers. Flying, look at Summers stop that. A catapult catching herself, a cartwheel and a drop kick, a second drop kick. Puts Joyce Grable down. A third drop kick misses. Oh, Grable suckered her in. She lured her in, and Summers tried that drop kick and it missed because Grable stepped back. Grable using her head got out of the way. Richter. A backflip. They catch Summers in the air. Oh, and Summers thrown down heavily on her neck and shoulders. Richter then catches Fontaine, a forearm smash, knocking her off the apron. I guess you would call that a reverse body slam by Joyce Grable as she literally dropped Carol Summers right on her head with a little bit of help from Wendy Richter. Well, I guess that's why they have the belts.
Crusher Blackwell and Dewey Robertson are next, so don't go away. In a match with Bill Styles, huge Crusher Blackwell made a quick name for himself on Wrestling at the Chase. Blackwell tips the scales at 480 pounds.
Drop kick by Blackwell! Oh, can you believe that? Blackwell came out with a drop kick and nearly took off Styles' head. Blackwell whips Styles into the corner, retreats. Where's Blackwell? Look at this! Oh, my goodness! Blackwell!
Good time, Matilda.
Blackwell just made Styles part of the ring post. Forearm smash by Blackwell. Oh, a knee drop to the back of Styles. Get ready in the emergency room unless Styles can turn things around. A diving headbutt into the back by Blackwell. Oh, my goodness. 482 pounds flying around that ring like a jet. I wonder what the air controllers think of that when they see it on their radar screen. Oh. Blackwell lifting Styles, retreating to the ropes. Oh, look out.
Oh.
Styles just mashed into the mat. And that's it. The running body slam by Crusher Blackwell.
As awesome as Blackwell is, he ran into tough sledding thanks to classy Dewey Robertson during a handicap tag bout. Robertson's partner was Tom Malley.
Robertson reaching out for Malley. Malley unable to make the tag. Blackwell lifts Malley with a body slam. Blackwell retreating. Takes to the air, leg drop.
Oh.
I think I can safely describe that as a giant leg drop. Count of one. Oh, Blackwell wouldn't pin him. Blackwell could have pinned him, and he wouldn't do it. He wanted to hurt him. Blackwell could have pinned him there, and he wouldn't do it. Robertson with a fist clench, staring at Blackwell. Blackwell again refusing to pin the man. Robertson yells in at the other referee, why don't you stop him? The man may be hurt. Blackwell strutting. And again, Blackwell and Robertson yell one another, and the referee chases Dewey Robertson back to the corner. How do you like that, says Crusher Blackwell. Malley, really groggy. I think Blackwell could have pinned him before and just refused to do it. Oh, running body slam by Blackwell. This could be it. Oh, tag's made. A tag was made, and Robertson comes into Blackwell. Looked like Blackwell had him down, and Robertson was tagged in. Blackwell got in the wrong corner after that running body slam. Headbutt by Blackwell knocks Robertson out of the ring. Oh, Blackwell's going out after him. Blackwell going out of the ring after Dewey Robertson. Blackwell pounds on Robertson outside the ring. Another smash by Blackwell and Dewey Robertson outside the ring. A shot to the stomach by Blackwell. Blackwell, a forearm smash. Robertson trying to keep his feet. Blackwell, oh, he tried to run him into the post. Robertson stopped it and slam! Blackwell, head first into the post. And Blackwell doesn't even seem fazed. Robertson and Blackwell battling outside the ring. I think the referees reached a count of 20. Blackwell again. Run headfirst into the ring post by Dewey Robertson. And Blackwell, not even moving, Robertson grabs a chair. And we have a confrontation outside the ring between Robertson and Blackwell, who I do believe are both counted out outside the ring. Tom Malley, he's out of the picture. The crowd's starting to yell, Dewey, Dewey, Dewey. The referee's trying to keep Robertson and Blackwell apart. Now Blackwell grabs a chair. Blackwell grabbing a chair, and Robertson and Blackwell. Blackwell beating himself in the head with the chair, as though to tell Robertson, you can't hurt my head. That guy is rather unbelievable. Now Robertson offering a challenge to Blackwell. The referee's trying to keep him apart. Well, let's go to Mickey. Well, maybe we won't, because Blackwell trying to get back in, and Eddie Smith and Lee Warren have their work cut out keeping these two apart. Robertson wanting a piece of Blackwell, daring him to come into the ring.
More action is coming on the Best of Wrestling at the Chase. More action is coming on the Best of Wrestling at the Chase. Big Thunder has been rumbling loudly. Gene Kaniski looks better than ever, and he had a punishing struggle when he faced Bob Sweetan.
Sweetan wades in with a punch to the ribs of Kaniski. Sweetan with a punch to the jaw, and Kaniski's knocked down by Sweetan. Sweetan knows this is time. He's got to go. He's got to turn it on. So he put everything he had into those punches and knees. Sweetan, now that could have been the thumb into the throat of Kaniski. I couldn't tell if it was the thumb or the side of the hand, but it certainly took a toll on Kaniski. Sweetan drops Kaniski with a kick. And now Sweetan stands on the throat, steps on the throat. You can see Sweetan still favoring that left arm, and everything he's doing is with the right arm or with the legs. Kaniski with a punch to the stomach. A hard kick from Kaniski. Kaniski catches Sweetan coming from the ropes with a knee to the stomach. Kaniski whips Sweetan into the corner. Sweetan lifts that knee, drops Kaniski, covers his shoulder. He's got his foot on the ropes, count of two, and the referee spots Sweetan using the ropes to try and put the shoulders of Kaniski down. The referee very alert there, seeing what was happening. Sweetan, though, although foiled in that bid to pin Kaniski by his illegal use of the ropes, oh, he's going for the pile driver. That's especially the pile driver. Sweetan, the pile driver on Kaniski. This could be it. Sweetan, the ropes. Kaniski's feet are on the ropes. Kaniski got his legs on the ropes after Sweetan delivered the pile driver, but this could be it. The Farmer World Champion in trouble. The pile driver from Sweetan. Kaniski pushes Sweetan into the corner, drives the shoulder to the stomach again. Kaniski still groggy from that pile driver. He finds Sweetan behind him. He lifts Sweetan. Backbreaker. The backbreaker by Kaniski. He covers Sweetan. Count of two and three. That's it. Gene Kaniski pins Bob Sweetan with a backbreaker after surviving the pile driver.
None are smoother and quicker than Ted DiBiase, who displayed his many great skills against David Oswald.
DiBiase take advantage of what's there, take advantage of what's presented to him. Had the hammerlock briefly and ends up with a side headlock. We talked about Ted DiBiase having it all in terms of youth and intelligence and skills. Many of a few ladies out there watching say he also has good looks. All I know is when he comes into a building, he sure gets just mobbed by them. I don't think he minds it either.
A classy guy on top of it.
Very classy guy, definitely.
Real class.
Real fine gentleman. DiBiase working on the neck of David Oswald, bouncing that shoulder in there and stretching out the neck. Good, hard, tight wrestling right now by Ted DiBiase. But if things get wild and woolly, well, we'll ask Harley Race about that. He found out the hard way when things get wild and woolly what Ted DiBiase can do.
5 minutes have expired, 15 minutes left.
DiBiase yanks the man over, but cannot hold the shoulders out. Look at him right back on top of Oswald. Oswald can barely breathe. DiBiase is all over him like flypaper. DiBiase squeezing the head with that side headlock. Oswald forces his way up. Grabs the hair of Ted DiBiase. Warren tells me, get that hand off. Knee lift into the midsection by Oswald. Oswald pounding on the back of Ted DiBiase. Oswald knowing that it's rather useless to try and match holds with DiBiase, at least in this match today. DiBiase obviously is sharp and has everything going. He tries to rough up DiBiase. Oh, DiBiase fights back. Mickey Garagiola says, uh-oh, look out for that temper. Hard chop to the throat. Oh, did you hear that sizzler? Oswald jammed into the turnbuckles. DiBiase brings Oswald out, goes to the side. Side saddle suplex, crashing David Oswald to the mat. DiBiase hooks the head, goes underneath. What have we here? Oh, DiBiase going for the suplex. A message for Harley Race from Ted DiBiase, the suplex that Race himself uses. And there's a count of three. DiBiase using the suplex to pin David Oswald.
A proven headliner around the globe, Rocky Johnson is a dynamic, innovative wrestler. David Price found that out the hard way.
First, Price got kicked in one jaw, and then he got punched in the other. Price gouges the eyes of Rocky Johnson. Again, Price in working on the face of Rocky Johnson. A clock to the head. Another punch from David Price. Price pounding on Rocky Johnson. Johnson slammed into the turnbuckle. I don't know if that had a whole lot of effect as Johnson's head hit the buckle. No, it did not. And Rocky grabs Price and slams him into the buckle. Price flails away at Rocky Johnson. He's opening up, throwing the rule book away. Let him out of the corner, yells the referee. Price whips Johnson to the ropes. He gets ready to throw a punch, and Rocky Johnson was gone. Price retreats to the ropes. Price was ready to throw a punch at Rocky. Rocky cartwheeled away, and Price was so unnerved by the move that he retreated to the ropes. Another quick jab by Rocky Johnson. Johnson daring Price to come to him. I think Rocky was upset for more than anything that Price moved away from contact, from combat.
5 minutes of a lap, 5 minutes left.
Price, side headlock on Rocky Johnson. Rocky pitches into the ropes. Rocky hits the ropes too. Both men flying. Price ducks. Price waiting. Oh, Rocky goes to the hanging backbreaker with an airplane spin. Look at that. A backbreaker and an airplane spin combined. Johnson cradles the leg, and he covers Price. And that is it. A spectacular move by Rocky Johnson.
Referees have trouble, too. Stick around to see why. The most difficult job in sports is being the referee. No decision can satisfy everyone. The job can get pretty rough physically, too. In fact, that's what happened when Lee Warren was the referee for a battle between Bulldog Bob Brown and Yvonne Roschke.
He covers Brown. Count of one. Count of two. Brown kicks away. Roschke lining Brown up for the claw. The claw. Brown blocks it. Brown blocks the brain claw of Roschke. The claw being blocked by Bulldog Brown. Roschke straining, trying to get the claw on Brown. Look how close he is. Roschke trying to get that claw on Brown. Brown reaches up and gouges the eyes of Roschke. Oh, so close for Roschke. And the crowd urges on Brown.
10 minutes have expired, 10 minutes left.
Roschke pounding on the back of Bulldog Brown. That's still the vulnerable point on Brown. Body slam by Roschke. He covers Brown to go for a pin. No luck there. Brown's tougher than that. Brown staggering, favoring that back. Roschke lifted to the air by Brown. He suckered Roschke to him and scored with his own body slam. Count of one. Roschke kicks up, gets that shoulder up. Brown following Roschke, the chop to the throat. Brown again lifts Roschke. Roschke grabs the rope and pulls Brown over the top rope with him. Oh, Brown slams his head and arm against a chair at ringside. One of the spectators vacated the area. Roschke pounding on Brown outside the ring. Brown trying to fight back. Brown grabs Roschke's head, and Brown, though, is pushed away. Brown pushed away into the steel ring post. The count, Roschke chased back by the referee, and he has to start the count over because Roschke would not get back. Brown tried to run Roschke's head into the ring post. Instead, it was Roschke who shoved Brown off, and Brown hit the ring post after he'd already hit a chair at ringside with his head. Roschke being pushed back again by the referee. Brown up to the apron. He slams his shoulder into the stomach of Yvonne Roschke. Roschke pounding on Brown. This is turning into Donnybrook. Brown working on the eyes of Yvonne Roschke. Brown battering Roschke now. Both of these men showing the ability to absorb punishment and still fight back. Brown pounding on Roschke. Lee Warren trying to get him back. Oh, and Brown throws the referee aside. Brown Roschke, and Roschke belts the referee. Down goes Lee Warren. Warren has been decked by both men, first Brown and then Roschke. They're over on top. Warren calling for the bell. Warren calling for the bell after he'd been decked first by Brown and then by Roschke. Brown and Roschke going at it hot and heavy. Referee Lee Warren trying to separate the two. Roschke backflip by Brown. Warren trying to pull the two apart, and Roschke crawls out of the ring.
Two referees had their hands full restoring order when Greg Valentine tangled with Kerry Von Erich in what turned out to be a full-fledged war.
Greg Valentine yanks Kerry Von Erich into the middle of the ring and then drops his full body weight into the thigh. Of course, whenever you think of Valentine, you think of the Brain Buster, the first man to use the elbow successfully, and Greg follows in those footsteps. But Greg is also proficient with the figure four leg lock, so keep that in mind. Kerry knows he's in a war. He fights back against Valentine and knocks Valentine to the ropes. A kick to the stomach by Kerry Von Erich. Flying mare by Kerry. To the air. Oh, the elbow drop misses. The elbow drop misses as Greg Valentine rolled away. Valentine grabs Kerry and pitches him right through the ropes and out of the ring, down to the cement floor. Greg Valentine going out of the apron. Myers warns Valentine to come back, but instead Valentine goes out after Kerry. He grabs Kerry by the hair. Look out! If we're still on the air out here, Kerry Von Erich has been viciously slammed into the press table twice by Greg Valentine, and Kerry is hurting outside the ring. Valentine really just slammed him into that table. He crushed one of the glass cups here, and I don't know that Kerry could possibly even be bleeding after hitting that cup. He hit the bell once, and Greg Valentine showing a real killer streak. He grabs Kerry Von Erich, pulls him up to the apron, bends it backward over the rope, and slams that forearm right into the chest of Kerry Von Erich. A vicious assault by Greg Valentine on Kerry Von Erich outside the ring, and now Von Erich trapped along the apron. Sonny Myers knocked down by Greg Valentine. Von Erich knocks Valentine back, and now Kerry Von Erich tears into Greg Valentine. This crowd going berserk. It's Kerry Von Erich ripping into Greg Valentine. The arm whipped to the ropes. Oh, Valentine nailed Von Erich with an elbow smash, the Brain Buster right to the head. Von Erich down and stunned. Valentine grabs Von Erich, pitches him out again. Greg Valentine, a man possessed, going back out after Kerry Von Erich. He grabs Von Erich from behind, hoists him to the air. Where is he going? Atomic knee drop. The atomic knee drop by Valentine. He lines him up for the Brain Buster. The Brain Buster outside the ring on Kerry Von Erich. Myers going out to get Myers shoved away again by Greg Valentine. The Brain Buster misses. The Brain Buster misses, and Valentine hit the cement floor. Von Erich pounding on Valentine. Battling outside the ring. Myers trying to break it up. Sonny Myers trying to pull the two apart. Here comes the other referee. They're calling for the bell. Valentine and Von Erich in a brawl. Lee Warren's been hit. We have a riot outside the ring. Warren and Myers trying to pull Valentine and Von Erich apart. Von Erich and Valentine up against the canvas wall. It's a Donnybrook between Kerry Von Erich and Greg Valentine.
Harley Race gets the spotlight following these messages. With or without the World Heavyweight Championship, Harley Race has a way of being in the middle of the action. Watch what happened when Ted DiBiase and Spike Huber took on Benny Romeo and J.J. Dillon, and Romeo was injured.
Romeo pulls Huber to the corner and slams Huber head first into the turnbuckle. DiBiase steps into the ring, wants to come over and help his partner. The outside referee, Lee Warren, chases DiBiase back where he belongs. Here comes J.J. Dillon into the ring, a hard kick from Dillon. Dillon on the neck of Huber with that elbow. A punch to the mouth of Spike Huber by J.J. Dillon. Dillon lifts Huber. Huber skips behind him and tags Ted DiBiase. DiBiase comes into the ring and he tears into J.J. Dillon. Flying heel by the Missouri State champion. Drop kick by Ted DiBiase. DiBiase with a flying mare on J.J. Dillon. Oh, knee drop across the chest. If it had been the throat, it would have been an automatic disqualification, but it was right on the chest. It was legal. DiBiase catches Romeo coming off. Falling body slam. DiBiase with a spinning toe hold and into the figure four leg lock. The figure four leg lock by Ted DiBiase on Benny Romeo. Yanking back, jerking on the ligaments and the cartilage. Romeo crying out in pain. The same figure four leg lock that put Ken Butera in the hospital for knee surgery. And it records the first fall of this match for the team of Ted DiBiase and Spike Huber against J.J. Dillon and Benny Romeo.
When Romeo could not continue in the second fall, Harley Race came to ringside to aid Dillon, who was on his own against two opponents.
Huber charging after Dillon. Oh, Race grabbing Huber from outside the ring, dumps him. Now the referees go outside the ring trying to chase him back. Dillon on his own against Huber and DiBiase. Tag made to DiBiase. Race arguing with Lee Warren outside the ring. Here comes Sam Muchnick down to ringside. And Sam Muchnick going after Race to try and get Harley Race out of there. Sam and Harley Race to the far corner of the ring. Maybe we can get a shot of him. Race yelling at Muchnick. I'm sure he's complaining about why Dillon should have to be alone. Why should he have to be in a handicap tag match just because his partner is injured? Muchnick said, okay. Sam Muchnick approving Harley Race to be the partner of J.J. Dillon. I assume that's what happened. Yes, he said okay. Lee Warren nodding. Race, okay, Race is the partner of J.J. Dillon. DiBiase taking his lumps, and there's a tag made to Harley Race. Dillon thrown away. I don't know if DiBiase knows Race is in there. Oh, Dillon! Dillon crashes right into Harley Race, knocking him right over the top rope. There's DiBiase going for the figure four leg lock. DiBiase with the figure four on J.J. Dillon. DiBiase, who's already crippled Benny Romeo, with the figure four leg lock on Dillon. Here comes Race on the top rope. Race on the top rope. Diving headbutt from the top rope by Harley Race. The referees call for the bell, and I'm sure that Race has been disqualified for diving onto Ted DiBiase on the top rope. DiBiase sees Race there, and DiBiase is after Race. DiBiase is after Race. DiBiase pounding on the world champion. He knocks Race through the ropes and onto the apron. DiBiase after Race outside slams him head first into the steel ring post. Ted looked up and saw that Race was on that top rope. Race diving up the top rope to get DiBiase. Race is bleeding. Race is bleeding. DiBiase has pounded open the head of Harley Race. Race is bleeding. Ted DiBiase shoves the referee away, knocks Riley down. DiBiase pounding on the world champion. DiBiase whips Race to the rope. Catches him coming off with a backflip. Race has already been disqualified. The match is officially over. But Race going after, taking a battering from DiBiase again. Race knocked clear over the top rope by Ted DiBiase. DiBiase, a man possessed, when he saw Race come off the top rope, clearly an attempt to injure Ted DiBiase. It backfired on Race. Oh, Race head first into the steel ring post by the Missouri champion, Ted DiBiase. Race has been injured by DiBiase. Race getting pounded. Look out. Race. DiBiase trying to be restrained by Huber, Warren, and Chuck Riley. DiBiase pounding Race right out of the building.
The rugged Race did not have the gold belt when he met David Von Erich, but things still exploded in fast and furious fashion.
Harley blinking, his eyes look glassy, but he still knows where Von Erich is. He scored with a punch. Von Erich fighting back. Race and Von Erich both showing the signs of this grueling duel. Neither man able to come up with the right combination to put his opponent down. Oh, did Race ever slam that head in there to the jaw of Von Erich? I don't think David's going to be eating steak tonight. He'll be sipping through his straw. He's taking some shots to the jaw from Race. Race going for the suplex. Race gets him, the suplex by Race. That's Race's favorite. When he's in the most trouble, he'll try that suplex. Race going up on the second rope. He's legal from there. He's legal. He's lining him up for that diving headbutt and misses. David rolled away. David going up on the ropes himself. David's legal from there. Giants, that's a claw. No, he went for a diving claw. He has the claw on Race.
3 minutes left. 3 minutes.
For the second time in this fabulous battle, it's David Von Erich with the Iron Claw and Harley Race. Race trying to get away, looking for those ropes again. David kicks the hands off the ropes. David kicking the hands off the ropes. He has Race in the middle. There's plenty of time left, still over 2 minutes remaining. I don't care how tough Race is, I don't think even he can hang on under the stress of the Iron Claw that long. Race grabbing the referee, and Race! Oh, Race slamming the referee, Charles Van Ader, into David Von Erich. Van Ader cracked his head into the jaw of Von Erich. Von Erich pitched through the ropes and out of the ring by Race. The referee is down and injured. Race going outside the ring after David Von Erich. David stunned after hitting head first with the referee. He's going for a suplex outside the ring on the concrete floor. Oh, Race with a suplex on David Von Erich outside the ring. If David's been hurt, his leg's quivering. He's been hurt. The referee calling for the bell. I'm sure he's going to disqualify Race for slamming him into Von Erich, but that doesn't no way justify what Race just did to David Von Erich. Race going up on the top rope. Race slapping at Van Ader. David Von Erich has been injured. Down on the floor, badly hurt. He's holding his shoulder. Here comes Kerry Von Erich. Von Erich pushes Race into the ring. Kerry Von Erich shoving Race away from the Van Ader and also the injured. Von Erich, Kerry ripping off his jacket. Kerry Von Erich, see what has happened to his brother. Kerry Von Erich after Race. Kerry drops Race. Race diving out of the ring, falling into the table, crawling behind our table to get away from Kerry Von Erich.
Ken Patera and Dick the Bruiser are up next on the best of Wrestling at the Chase. Ken Patera claims to be the world's strongest wrestler, and Tim Leonard probably would not argue after he battled Patera.
Again, Patera lifting Leonard. Where's he going with him? The shoulder breaker, jamming the shoulder. That's a good way to separate someone's shoulder. The shoulder breaker by Ken Patera. Patera covers Leonard, and he won't pin him.
5 minutes have elapsed, 10 minutes left.
Leonard obviously finished, and Patera drops him throat first across the top rope. Ken Patera, really no reason for that. He's proven himself superior at this point. He had the man down clearly for a pin and then refused to pin him. Patera now is dishing out punishment to Tim Leonard. That shoulder breaker probably had turned the trick for Patera, but he's still not satisfied. Patera battering the head of Leonard into that top turnbuckle. Now Leonard desperately, in desperation, fighting back. Patera just took those forearm smashes and then gouged the eyes. The forearm smashes had no effect whatsoever on Ken Patera. A man of iron. Patera whips Leonard to the ropes and clotheslines Leonard, nearly bending him backwards, nearly splitting him in half. Look out, Patera moving behind Leonard. There's the full Nelson. The full Nelson and the swinging neck breaker. Patera whirling Leonard around. Tremendous pressure into the neck by Patera. Patera leaning into the neck with that swinging neck breaker. Leonard's going to have no choice but to submit. It's either that or go to the hospital. Leonard being pushed forward. He gives up, and Ken Patera simply tramples Tim Leonard. The count of three, he's going to get disqualified if he doesn't break that swinging neck breaker, which of course ends up in the full Nelson.
When Crusher Blackwell teamed with Patera to form a dangerous combination, Dick the Bruiser couldn't stop himself from helping Spike Huber and Bruce Reed.
Blackwell had enough presence of mind to see what Reed had in mind. He cut him off. And just when Blackwell seemed to be getting into some trouble, he managed to turn things around. The front face lock by Crusher Blackwell on Bruce Reed. And look at Blackwell roll him over. He wants to get to the corner where Patera is, and he uses his head and his strength to make it work and pull Reed to the corner. Patera working with the knee lifts to the back of Bruce Reed. The referee balling out Patera for using the tights to set up those knee lifts. Reed comes off with a forearm smash. Reed goes between the legs and makes the tag with Huber. Patera right on top of Huber. Patera and Huber toe-to-toe, and Huber's getting the better of it. Spike Huber pounding on the Missouri champion. Oh, Patera taking his lumps from Spike Huber. Down goes the Missouri King. Huber pounds on the head of Ken Patera. He covers the Missouri ruler. Count of one, and then Patera throws Huber off. Patera with a shot to the stomach. He is tough, but so is Huber, and Huber is showing that exactly, toe-to-toe to Patera. Again, Patera dropped down by Huber. Huber rolls Patera over, tries to cover Patera. Patera threw him off. All that raw strength comes in pretty handy now and then for Ken Patera. Huber pounds Patera into the corner. And I have to tell you that Spike Huber at this point is really dishing out the punishment, really giving a battering to Ken Patera. To the air. Can he keep him up there? He spins in the airplane spin by Huber. The airplane spin. Down goes Patera. Try for the pin. Here comes Crusher Blackwell. Oh, Blackwell with an elbow drop to the back of Huber. And now Reed is after Blackwell. Reed pounds Blackwell to the ropes. Huber down and hurt. Patera catches Reed from behind with a knee. Blackwell backing up. Where's Blackwell going? Huber's still down. Oh, Blackwell crushes Reed against the buckles. Reed knocked out of the ring by Blackwell. Blackwell and Patera double teaming. Oh, together they manhandle Huber, throw him to the ropes and into the ring post. Reed is hurt. I think Huber's hurt. Huber is hurt after being double teamed and thrown into the post. Patera just battering Huber, manhandling him. The crowd in an uproar as Ken Patera batters Spike Huber. Reed fighting back against Blackwell outside the ring. Patera and Huber are the two. Here's Dick the Bruiser. Here's the Bruiser. He's wrestling later. Here comes the Bruiser. The Bruiser after Patera. That's his son-in-law in there, Smith, trying to stop him. We have a Donnybrook. The Bruiser all over Patera. Patera whipped to the ropes. Up, over the top. Dick the Bruiser coming to the rescue of Huber and Reed. The Bruiser daring Patera. He's all over Patera again, pounding on him. Huber and Reed battering Blackwell. Patera's been knocked out of the ring, and he's going right out of the ring to the dressing room.
Flamboyant Ric Flair is featured right after this. Arrogant Ric Flair was hot on the trail of the World Heavyweight Championship when he opposed Pat O'Connor, who has since retired and is now the matchmaker.
That's Ric Flair. He does it with style, my friends.
That's what you call a classy guy.
Forearm smash by Nature Boy Ric Flair. He pounds on Pat O'Connor. O'Connor pulled out to the center of the ring and once more the front face lock.
10 minutes have expired. 10 minutes left.
Flair keeps his shoulders up as O'Connor tried to cradle him, but just couldn't get that leg. O'Connor underneath again for that low suplex. O'Connor pulls his head out. The head is free. That low suplex finally did the job. O'Connor spins Flair, trying to go for that backslide. It nearly worked before. Flair struggling against it. He's finally forced down. Lifts the arm right out, though. It was worth a try. It almost worked before. No question about that. Flair with a forearm smash. O'Connor with one. Flair and O'Connor. O'Connor hooks Flair, and both men go tumbling over the top rope and outside the ring. Flair and O'Connor both outside the ring. A heavy spill over that top rope. Neither man really in control of his body. They both went tumbling over the ropes. An elbow smash to the head by Flair. O'Connor pulls Flair back down and slams O'Connor into the ring apron. O'Connor trying to get back into the ring after slamming Flair into the apron. O'Connor reaches out for Flair, but it's Flair who grabs O'Connor, and Flair has O'Connor outside the ring and jams his knee into the steel ring post. Ric Flair jamming the knee of Pat O'Connor into the steel ring post. Flair ramming that knee into the post. Oh, Flair spotted an opening, and he's just like a shark going after blood. Flair punishing that leg around the ring post, and Pat O'Connor walked right into trouble there as Flair grabbed O'Connor and slammed that knee twice and then twisted it around the ring post. Flair punishing the leg of Pat O'Connor, spins it around the toe, going for the figure four leg lock. O'Connor breaks it, pulls that forward, try for a pin, but the legs of Flair are free, could not be cradled. Flair going for that leg again, trying to go for the injured leg of Pat O'Connor. O'Connor trying to keep his balance. O'Connor, seeing a wound on Flair's forehead, begins to pound on the head of Flair. And Flair, bleeding from an earlier wound that had been opened in a match, the head of Ric Flair opened up by Pat O'Connor. O'Connor pounding on the bloody head of Nature Boy Ric Flair. O'Connor's knee is hurt. He knew he was in trouble, and he went right for the head of Flair. Flair bleeding, the blood pouring through the blonde hair of Nature Boy Ric Flair. Something else that Ted DiBiase can attack, maybe, but more importantly, it's something that Pat O'Connor, who's still favoring that leg, can attack. Flair, the blood streaming down his head. There's the sleeper! The sleeper by Pat O'Connor on Nature Boy Ric Flair. Flair bleeding and trapped in the sleeper. Oh, both men go flying over that top rope again as O'Connor and Flair went to the ropes. Flair, the blood pouring off his head. O'Connor, oh, he almost lost his balance when he got up with that bad knee. Flair misses a punch. O'Connor with the sleeper outside the ring. The sleeper outside the ring. O'Connor and Flair. O'Connor with the sleeper. Oh, O'Connor jammed backwards. O'Connor jammed backwards into the steel ring post. The bloody Ric Flair. He's going for the figure four. Flair with the figure four on O'Connor outside the ring. The bloody Ric Flair with the figure four on Pat O'Connor outside the ring. The referee counting on both men. He's up to 15, 16, both men being counted on. Flair, the blood streaming down his face. The count's up to 19, Flair's in the ring. O'Connor with the injured knee is outside the ring. And Nature Boy Ric Flair has the victory. O'Connor counted out outside the ring. O'Connor has been injured, slammed backwards into the steel ring post. And then Flair applying the figure four leg lock outside the ring. O'Connor has been hurt. He can't straighten that leg out, and Ric Flair, even bleeding, had what it takes to come up with a victory.
Today, Ric Flair is the world heavyweight champion. He is the man everyone else is after. Watch as Flair squares off with Roy Rogers.
Flair pulls Rogers off the ropes and throws him through the ropes and right out into the front row, practically. A hard spill to the cement floor. Compliments of the Nature Boy who struts around that ring. How long can he keep up that pace he's at? Night after night, the gold belt on the line, living as fast and hard as he does. Ric Flair doesn't seem to be any the worse for wear. He yells at the referee. He's just battering the young Roy Rogers around. Rogers in there with a man who is simply at the peak of his game. Look at Ric Flair batter Roy Rogers, the world champion. Oh, that Flair, just a mile a minute pace. Never stops, just keeps going. Rogers is being battered by Ric Flair. Rogers on the apron, pulled into the ring by the world champion. Flair whips Rogers the ropes, catches him with an elbow to the chin.
5 minutes have elapsed, 5 minutes left.
The world champion grasps Rogers to the side, saddle, suplex. Flair covers Rogers. Rogers manages to get his shoulder up, and don't ask me how, because he has taken a pounding from the world champion. Flair takes a shot to the stomach, and maybe youth and stamina are going to pay off for Rogers. He landed a couple of blows, but Flair hangs in there, knee lift to the head. Ric Flair, he played football, wrestled at the University of Minnesota. He's got a tremendous athletic background. Flair caught in a jackknife and cradle. Hey, the champion's shoulders are down, but only for a count of one. Flair quickly back up on top. He grabs Rogers, has him in the air, setting him up. Oh, pile driver. The pile driver by the world champion, Ric Flair. Rogers' foot is on the bottom rope. There'll be no count of three here. And maybe it's a good thing for Rogers. He landed where he did. Rogers gasping. His eyes are glassy. I don't think he knows he's in the ring, but he certainly knows he's in there with a tornado. A gaudy, colorful, charismatic tornado named Ric Flair. The world champion pounding with those forearms. And I mean to tell you, he drives them home, just bangs them in there. Rogers pulled clear across the ring by Flair. He lifts Rogers to the air. Atomic knee drop, jamming the tailbone down into the knee.
Now you know he's wrestling the world champion.
Now he knows he's wrestling the world champion. So says Ric Flair. And I have to admit, I am impressed by Flair today so far. Flair has Rogers in the air. Suplex by Flair. Rogers is done. Flair still not satisfied. Flair still not satisfied. Elbow drop. Nature boy Ric Flair is dishing it out. He's going for the figure four. The figure four leg lock. The figure four, the one that rips ligaments apart. And Roy Rogers submits quickly. Ric Flair has just destroyed Roy Rogers. Flair absolutely made mincemeat out of Rogers, a good young wrestler. But the world champion wanted to let everybody know he has what it takes to wear the gold belt. Here's Mickey.
In 6 minutes and 58 seconds with the figure four, the winner, the world's heavyweight champion, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
So that's a lot of action and a lot of stars with just some of the highlights from Wrestling at the Chase over the past 12 months. Wrestling at the Chase is back next weekend, same time, same place, and one of the standouts on hand will be Gene Kaniski. So until next weekend, this is Larry Matisik saying thanks for watching. We appreciate it, and so long.
You've been watching Wrestling at the Chase. This program has been presented in cooperation with the St. Louis Wrestling Club.
Patera and maybe settle some scores that obviously have built up between Patera and Blackwell. The arm stretched by Atlas on Ken Patera. If you were in that position, Crusher Blackwell, how would you escape?
I'd go to the ropes. I'd be smart. I'd go to the ropes.
How about that roll up? Beautifully done by Ken Patera, rolling right up the body to a side headlock. You have to admire the science and the quickness there of Patera, don't you? Patera with that side headlock, and Crusher Blackwell silent at the speed that Ken Patera has displayed. Of course, as Crusher himself pointed out, Blackwell used to weigh 350 pounds. Today he came in around 256. He's trimmed down. He's a
Mr.
sleek
Patera,
athlete.
I think you made a mistake there. He's the one that used to weigh 350, sir. But let me tell you something. We just seen a move a minute ago when he arm-dragged him and tucked the arm. That shows that size and strength is not everything.
A monkey flip by Patera. Beautiful move, beautiful bridge by Atlas. Oh, some great wrestling both ways, and I think even Crusher Blackwell would admit that.
He's coming up with some moves that I didn't expect him to come up with.
You're commenting about Patera there, in other words.
That's
he's surprising
right.
You. Well now, maybe that will also serve as a surprise for Ric Flair. Mark Romero may have some surprises for Crusher Blackwell. Count of one, count of two. Blackwell.
Right there shows the strength of Ken Patera.
Body scissors by Patera on Atlas. The strength right there coming into play, that body scissors, because of the power in Patera's body from a very awkward position, Crusher. Count of one on the shoulders of Ken Patera. It's a body scissors by Patera on Atlas.
See, right here is the only mistake he's making. He's close enough. Why don't he just go for his eyes and come out of the hole and he'll be on top again.
There's a difference in philosophy there. That obviously the philosophy of Crusher Blackwell. Atlas in a position where if he could break the body scissors, he might be able to counter with a Boston Crab, and Patera has to squirm around. Atlas going for the Boston Crab. That's the way out of the body scissors, if he can get that leg over. Power.
Shows
too much
power. Shows the
strength
of the legs, of course. Any man that can pick up 535 pounds over his head, his legs, his arms, his chest, he's just well-proportioned. He's a strong man.
Not just upper body strength.
That's right.
And at one time, of course, I'm sure Crusher Blackwell's well aware, Ken Patera had some knee problems, but he did have knee surgery. It's been over a year now, and I think anybody who's had knee surgery will tell you it takes a year to get back to 100%, and Patera now obviously 110.
Well, see, there's another mistake. Patera shouldn't go around telling his problems. He's showing weaknesses, and sometimes those weaknesses can be advantages for your opponent.
Patera with a forearm smash, a legal blow, although they are up against the ropes. Another forearm smash by Ken Patera on Omar Atlas. An elbow smash to the neck, and there's Patera opening up. When he hits you with an elbow, you have to feel it. Forearm smash by Atlas as he comes off the ropes. The chancery by Atlas on Patera. Atlas turns Patera in the corner. The referee wants a break, but before Atlas can break, oh, the whip reversed. Atlas hit the corner, Patera. Oh, big body slam. Elbow smash across the chest. Patera covers Atlas. Count of two before Atlas gets away. Jackknife cradle. Oh, what a move by Patera. What a surprise. Count of one, two, three. Crusher Blackwell did that.
He could
move
never
surprise
do that
you.
To me, though. I'll tell you.
Well, he did it with a front rolling cradle, and Patera chasing Blackwell right away from ringside. Ken Patera, jackknife and cradle, perfectly executed. And Ken Patera surprised a few people today, and a handshake by Patera for Omar Atlas. A real fine match. And Ken Patera puts up some, there's the pin, that jackknife and cradle, count of one, two, and three. Patera with the victory. And inside the ring, you'll see that Ken Patera puts on that symbolic gold. He wants a little more when he meets Ric Flair. Here's Mickey Garagiola.
In 8 minutes and 45 seconds, jackknife and cradle, the winner, Ken Patera.
Blackwell pulls back on the chin of Reed. Blackwell squeezing Reed's head. The crowd again chanting, yelling for Reed. Blackwell leading into Reed. Reed throws an elbow to the stomach of Blackwell. Another elbow to the stomach of Blackwell. A big smash to the chin. But Reed goes to work on Blackwell. A hard jab right to the chin. Another jab. Reed pounding on Blackwell. He winds up the haymaker. Blackwell whipped into the corner by Reed. Reed with an elbow as Blackwell comes off the ropes. Drop kick by Reed. Reed knocks Blackwell to the corner. Reed charges it. Oh, and catches a forearm smash right to the jaw. Blackwell. Side headlock on Reed. Oh, Reed tosses Blackwell to the ropes. Look out. Oh, giant splash right to the back of Reed. A giant splash on the back of Reed. Reed tried to duck beneath Blackwell, and Blackwell maneuvered, and there's a count of three, and the first fall belongs to Crusher Blackwell with the giant splash. We're going to get another look at it. Blackwell was in trouble, but he made a good move, the kind of move you expect when two of wrestling's best are inside that ring. Here it is. Look at Reed drop down. Blackwell stops, 470 pounds right into the back, right into Reed's back. Reed not only had the wind knocked out of him, but the back punished. And from there, Crusher Blackwell was able to roll Reed over and make the pin that gives him the first fall. Here's Mickey Garagiola.
The winner of the first fall, 11 minutes and 56 seconds, giant splash, the winner, Crusher Blackwell.
A blast right to the face, and that broke up the bear hug for Butch Reed. A punch to the stomach by Reed. Another blow to the midsection of Blackwell, and a double clout to the jaw. Blackwell by Butch Reed. Reed with a forearm smash. Blackwell whipped to the ropes by Reed. Reed comes flying off the other rope. Oh, what a forearm to the chin of Blackwell. Down goes Blackwell. Reed to the air. Right. Butch Reed leveling Blackwell. Reed hits the ropes again. Leg drop across the chest, trying to knock the wind out of Blackwell. Reed, the count of one, two, and Blackwell gets that shoulder up. That would have evened this match in a fall apiece.
15 minutes have elapsed, 5 minutes left.
Blackwell hits the rope. Oh, Reed has him and loses him. He lost him when he tried for one, two, and somehow Reed gets Blackwell off. Oh, I thought that was it. I thought it was two straight falls for Blackwell. Somehow Reed summoned all of that strength and threw the 470-pounder off of him. A kick to the stomach by Blackwell. What a battle. What a tremendous match on Wrestling at the Chase. Power slam. Hey, Reed, how long? Cradle. One, two, three. Reed. But Reed hits Blackwell. This crowd going berserk. Blackwell tried the power slam. And just as in the first fall, Blackwell made the right move at the crucial moment. Reed does the same thing right here. Let's take another look at it. Blackwell going for the power slam. Look at Reed hook that head. Grab the leg. Pull up on the leg underneath the knee. And Blackwell's shoulders trapped to the mat for the count of three. It's one fall apiece. And here is Mickey Garagiola.
One of the second fall in 3 minutes and 39 seconds. Butch Reed.
Knowing that Reed's back has taken a lot of punishment earlier in this match, knowing that the effects of that giant splash that Blackwell hit Reed with earlier might be starting to come into play here.
1 minute left, 1 minute.
1 minute remaining, and Reed slams his shoulder into the stomach of Blackwell. Reed went to the eyes of Blackwell just as Blackwell had done earlier to Reed. Blackwell comes off the rope. Reed comes flying to the other, flying cross body block. Blackwell caught him. Or did he? He loses it. Reed covers it. This could be it. One, two, oh, I mean within half a count. Butch Reed nearly pinned Blackwell right there. It was nearly Reed's victory. He came within a split second, a quarter of a second maybe even. Referee Lee Ward's hand was coming down. But Blackwell managed to throw Reed off. Blackwell with a blow to the head of Reed. Blackwell lifting Reed. Oh, so close that was for Butch Reed. Blackwell strangling Reed over the ropes. The referee trying to pull the two apart. Reed takes a punch to the head. Reed and Blackwell, there's the bell. The time limit has expired. Each man having a fall, but Blackwell and Reed are still at each other. Toe to toe, and Reed pounding on Blackwell. Reed grabs Blackwell, hurls him across the ring. And into the corner. Oh, a kick to the stomach by Blackwell. Blackwell and Reed still at it. Referee Lee Warren trying to pull the two apart. It's a Donnybrook. Lee Warren doing yeoman service, getting Butch Reed back. The time has expired. Each man winning a fall. Lee Warren doing a great job getting Reed back there. And let's try to get into that ring and get the official time and announcement from ring announcer Mickey Garagiola.
With time running out, each wrestler winning the fall, referee Lee Warren declares the match a draw.
Coming off the ropes, drives him with a kick to the head of Dean, getting extra momentum by running off the ropes. Brody arm whips Dean into the buckles. Dean taking the jolt in the corner. King Kong Brody pulls Dean forward, grabs the head. King Kong Brody setting Dean up. Dean trying to get down to one knee to protect himself. Brody lifts him up, hooks underneath, and King Kong Brody going for a pile driver. Brody can do just about anything he wants with Dean from that position. Pile driver. Oh, was that a dandy, a pile driver by King Kong Brody on Bruce Dean, count of one. Oh, Brody yanks Dean up by the hair. Half the crowd boos Brody, half the crowd cheers him. He's himself. Dean firing away desperately in desperation. Brody just stands there, takes it, goes to work on the eyes of Dean. Oh, a vicious kick to the head, nearly took Dean's head off. Another kick to the head by Brody. King Kong Brody stomping away on Bruce Dean. Any match you have with King Kong Brody, you come out black and blue. Brody, a kick to the chest on Bruce Dean. Brody lining Dean up. Dean coming to his feet. And pretty doggone slowly, Brody drops him with another kick. And those kicks, believe me, if he were a punter, he'd be averaging 50 yards. Brody, drop kick! Oh, the drop kick by King Kong Brody. 6'5", 290, and a drop kick from a man that size, reminiscent of somebody like Blackwell, those drop kicks. When you talk about people like a Crusher Blackwell or a King Kong Brody, you are talking a phenomenal type of athlete. Somebody who does something hardly anybody else in the world cannot do. Brody showing it to Bruce Dean firsthand. A second drop kick from King Kong Brody. That one right to the head. One to the ribs, one boot, the other boot to the head. And Bruce Dean, I'm sure, doesn't know if he's in St. Louis, Sacramento, or the East Coast. Body slam from Brody. Dean down, and he's just about out. Look out from above. King Kong Brody. Giant flying knee drop by Brody. The pin is a formality again for King Kong Brody. He is wrecking people, destroying them, just going through one after another. Brody, the giant greyhound, with another victory today over Bruce Dean. We'll get another look at it here. There's Dean down on the mat. Watch Brody. He's already hit Dean with a pair of drop kicks by this point. Watch Brody. Look how high he is. Look how high in the air he is. All that way, 290 pounds down on the top of Bruce Dean. No wonder Dean didn't get up from that. Here's Mick.
In 3 minutes and 47 seconds with flying knee drop, the winner, King Kong Brody.
By Orton. Cowboy Bob Orton so far making mincemeat out of Bruce Dean. A kick to the head by Cowboy Bob Orton. And Orton so far off to a fast start in his attempt to make an impression upon the fans in the area. Orton pulls back on the head. Actually, age-wise, Orton is a young man, Butch, but he has that experience from being around wrestling.
He has the experience. He's been around wrestling all of his life, you know. Second generation wrestler.
Just like the Von Erich boys.
Yes, and I'll tell you what, you know, he really goes out there and does his business real well.
Dean goes down. A couple of the fans on the other side of the ring yelled about the hair. If so, Orton certainly had it covered well, disguising it with his own body and away from the referee. Easier that way, says Orton to us. So you think he's telling us something right there. If there's a shortcut to be taken, he's not shy about taking it.
Well, you know, it's a lot of guys like Bob Orton Jr., you know, in professional wrestling today. If they need a shortcut, they'll take it. And whether they need it or not, sometimes these guys will take these shortcuts. Rather than the skills, they'll just use the shortcuts, the punches and the kicks, and have some little short, easy wins that way.
5 minutes have expired, 5 minutes left.
Cowboy Bob Orton against Bruce Dean. With us at ringside is Butch Reed. So far, it's been pretty much all Orton, and if he were scoring this match on an amateur basis, Orton would have a pretty substantial lead at this point. Bruce Dean needs to generate some offense, but you can see his eyes are a little glassy. Oh, Orton, the punch to the end, that one popped.
I'll tell you what, Larry, this Bruce Dean is really getting a wrestling lesson today. Chase. And after this match is over with, I believe that he'll have a lot of things on his mind, and he'll really think about it.
Big high knee, sort of a drop kick, but with the knee, flinging the knee out there. A bit of an unusual move by Orton. That made it that much more effective. Orton lifts Dean up on his shoulder. There's some of that strength. Oh, what could this be? Bob Orton lifting the man up on the rope. Oh, a punch to the jaw. Orton going up on the second rope. I've heard about this, the super suplex. You've never seen it here. If he can take, look out below. Oh,
what a suplex. What a suplex by Cowboy Bob Orton.
Cheering, part of that booing, and that was an impressive move by Cowboy Bob Orton. The superplex, I believe he calls it. Butch, we're going to get another look at it. He brought that man from so high up in the air. Look at this. Look where Orton is up on the second rope, grabbing Bruce Dean off the top rope. Look how high they are, 10 foot in the air. No wonder Bruce Dean didn't get up from that one. Cowboy Bob Orton, an impressive victory. Here's Mickey Garagiola.
in 6 minutes and 7 seconds with a suplex, the winner, Cowboy Bob Orton.
His vision. Kerry Von Erich goes underneath. Nice fireman's carry, Butch. Amateur move.
Yes, good amateur move. You know, these guys, the Von Erich brothers, they are second-generation wrestlers, too. And, you know, they have a good wrestling background. They have a good athletic background, period. All of the Von Erich brothers were good athletes in high school, college, and now professional wrestling.
And, of course, we're talking about Kevin. We're talking about David and now Kerry. It's worth mentioning with Kerry Von Erich going after the Missouri State Crown belonging to Harley Race. Kerry's brother Kevin once had that Missouri title. He took it away from Dick Murdoch, lost it to Ken Patera, so the Missouri championship is no stranger to the Von Erich family, and they'd like to bring it home again with Kerry doing the honors against Race, if he can. Oh, Kerry, big body slam. That Griffin has been fired around this ring pretty regularly by Kerry Von Erich. Again, Griffin gouging the face and eyes of Kerry Von Erich. Griffin wades into Von Erich.
5 minutes have passed, 15 minutes left.
Von Erich tries to pry Griffin off those ropes. Griffin hangs onto the headlock and throws a punch into the throat area of Kerry. Kerry, that Kerry Von Erich reminds me a lot of you because he can take punishment. He can take punishment and still come back.
He can take punishment, and just like myself, not bragging anything, but he can dish it out also.
Takes stamina, endurance.
Right.
Something that you don't gain in 6 months, do you?
A lot of time in the gym, a lot of time doing road work, a lot of training, in other words, Larry.
Pile driver by Kerry Von Erich, and Kerry showing us some new weapons that he's mastered. Kerry covers Griffin, kind of 1-2, and Griffin throws Von Erich off. Kerry takes a quick look at Griffin. I think he's earning some respect for the toughness of this scrappy character from Tennessee. Griffin whips Von Erich to the ropes. He throws an elbow that misses. Kerry, oh, the stomach claw! Oh, he lifts him with the stomach claw! Kerry Von Erich!
This could be all over right
oh,
here,
look at that, lifting him with the claw that flings him down and digs him with that stomach claw. And Billy Griffin says, I give up. Kerry Von Erich caught Griffin with that stomach claw.
That's
in a major that felt, Butch.
That's family tradition, Larry. That claw has been in the Von Erich clan for quite some time, and I don't think it's going anywhere. I think it's going to be right with them for a long time to come.
We're going to get another look at it. Of course, Fritz Von Erich was a man who developed and mastered. There's that stomach claw. Imagine what Griffin's feeling now. No way to protect himself. Von Erich digging him with those powerful arms of the stomach claw, and then Von Erich wants to make sure, so he slams him down. Digs in again with the stomach claw, and Griffin had to submit. Let's go to the ring, and Mickey Garagiola.
In 6 minutes and 11 seconds, the stomach claw, the winner, Kerry Von Erich.
Prepared to really give the people a workout, but as you can see, the competition just didn't quite stand up to the standards I need. And may I say one thing? I'm just sorry that you're all dressed up today and that I can't take this opportunity to show all these great wrestling fans that you obviously have no wrestling ability at all.
Oh, now, Rick, now
wait
Let
me
minute.
Tell you
How
something,
do you say
Flair.
Wrestling ability?
Don't let the clothes stop you. They can come off just as well as they come on this morning.
Yeah?
Right.
Get them off.
You offer me a challenge?
Hey, get them off.
In front of all these people, you offered me a challenge.
No, 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 no.
Again?
You open your mouth. You want to wrestle me? Get in TV.
You saying I have no wrestling ability at
I'm
all?
I'm saying you not only have no wrestling ability, you haven't got the class to be in the same ring with the world champion.
That's you mean fundamental.
Well,
now, wait a minute, Rick.
Instead of us passing words, why don't I just go in the ring?
Speaking after you, Butch. Butch Reed not backing down for a challenge. Butch Reed going to the ring. Taking his coat off. The crowd roaring. Well, Ric Flair, Rick. Man's up there. You want to try and see if he can sit out on you or switch? Are you going to accept this challenge, Rick?
Christmas. Right around the corner.
Very true. Rick, you got a challenge up there. I think it's either put up or shut up. You want to get in there and maybe you'll...
Like I said before, out of the goodness of my heart, this time with a great deal of pleasure will I get in there.
Ric Flair, okay, we'll see some basic fundamental wrestling. Let's put it down to the basics. Let's put it down amateur style. Flair shakes hands with Reed. We'll see who decides they want to go in a down position. They want to start head to head. Reed has apparently said that he will, well, will he? I don't know. They're debating who's going to go down position first. Flair says he'll give the advantage to Reed. Flair getting down. We saw, well, Flair escaped before from Andrews and Curtis Dean. Reed getting behind Flair. Now Flair complaining about where that hand is positioned legally. The referee checking it. Loran says wrestle. Flair sits out. Reed riding him. Flair sitting out, tried to switch. Flair trying to get away. Reed riding him, riding him. Flair rolls and ends up in the ropes. Well, Reed rode him and rode him and rode him. And Flair got away nowhere. Ric Flair, perhaps his ego has taken a bit of a jolt. Flair tells the referee, grab my sweatpants. Lee Warren says, no, I was watching carefully. You get down, says Ric Flair to Butch Reed. Reed getting down. And Ric Flair will be in the up position. Come on, says Reed, let's get to it. Flair getting down. They wrestle. Reed scooting around, sits out. Flair trying to hang on, and he loses him. And Reed would have credit for an escape there. Ric Flair not too happy about what's happening here. Can you do that one more time, Flair says. Want to try again? Fine with me, Rick. You're the guy in the ring. If you're the guy getting embarrassed if he gets away, it's fine with me. He tells Reed to get down again, hands and knees. Me down, says Reed. Is that what you want? Okay, fine. Butch Reed, I think, figures he's already proven a point. Flair debating which side he wants to start from. Go ahead. Oh, Flair with a kick in the ribs. And Flair grabs Curtis Dean and fires Dean right over the top rope. Andrews tries to intervene. Ric Flair, that ego, took a knock. Has a chop to Reed.